it's a good opportunity for people to meet, develop relationships, and try and take things forward. There is a very good group of people on WhatsApp, the Movement Disorder Society Pakistan WhatsApp group, and we share videos and we get a lot. I learn a lot from that group, and I would encourage all of you who are not a member of that group to consider joining MDSP. I won't take any more time, and I would just like to thank the organizers and the attendees and the faculty for making this possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nader. Now for the next topic, that is the clinical features and the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, I would like to invite Dr. Athar Javed. Dr. Athar Javed is head of Department of Neurology, King Edward Medical University, Lahore, and his efforts for the upgradation of neurology department in King Edward Medical University and otherwise are well recognized. He also actively participated in the formation of Movement Disorder Society of the Pakistan, and currently he is the Vice President of Pakistan Society of Neurology. So please welcome Dr. Athar Javed.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Dr. Sadaf, Professor Shaukat, Dr. Shahin Mustafa, and all dear participants and delegates. It's an honor to be in Karachi, and I'm very thankful to Professor Nader Ali Sayed for inviting me for this talk. So I will, without wasting, I will proceed with the presentation because today is Friday. So this is our second meeting. The first meeting of MDSP was held in Islamabad. So time passes so quickly. So I'm going to talk about very simple things that is clinical feature and diagnosis. But there has been, as mentioned by Professor Nader, that there has been recent development and changes in the diagnostic criteria and other things. So I have no conflict of interest, and my travel has been sponsored by Genetic Pharma, and the videos which I will present has been consented by the patients and relatives for teaching purposes. So I try to cover these things, that at the end of this talk we should be able to have all clinical motor and non-motor manifestation, atypical Parkinsonism, and how to differentiate, video presentation of couple of patients, and learn about update on the diagnostic criteria. So before we proceed, because if you learn something, let us see what are the changes before and at the end of this talk. So I have these 8 questions for you, and you just see, you have the pad and see what are your impression now. The new definition of Parkinson's disease define this disorder as synucleinopathy, bradykinesia is always present, yes or no. Postural instability is a core feature of Parkinson's disease, and presence of dementia exclude diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. Lack of response to high dose levodopa constitute absolute exclusion criteria for Parkinson's disease. Normal DAT scan exclude Parkinson's disease, cardiac sympathetic denervation, an MIBG scintigraphy is supportive of diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. And finally, the UKPDS, the brain bank criteria, is the latest diagnostic criteria available for Parkinson's disease. So I start with this question, and at the end we will conclude what are the right answers and what are the wrong answers. So Parkinson's disease, this is the most common after the Alzheimer's, the second most common neurodegenerative disorders affecting the brain, particularly associated with nigrostriatal dopamine deficiency, cell loss, and the presence of Lewy bodies, which stain for alpha-synuclein. And symptomatic, patient, when the patient is symptomatic, 50% of the nigral cell loss has occurred, and 80% of the dopamine deficiency is evident. Now this is self-explanatory video. If you see here, you will find all the classical feature of Parkinson's disease. So bradykinesia, rigidity, resting tremor, postural instability, flexed posture of the neck, trunk, limbs, and other features. So you can see this old man, mask-like face, bradykinesia, classical pinloading resting tremor, asymmetry more on the left side than on the right side, and you can see the gait, short step, narrow base, flexed two posture. So this is a classical patient of Parkinson's disease, which after seeing, I think you will not misdiagnose, and there are no atypical signs in this patient. He can write and the writing is very micrographia. And you can see the left hand sided tremor. Now, classical feature of tremors, again, I think few pages are here. So just go in detail. This is classically resting, slow, 4 to 6 hertz per second. And this is usually hands are affected more than the legs and then the face. And this is a prosupination movement of the hand. You may have postural tremor and action tremor in this patient in about 15% of the cases, and you may have re-emerging tremor. Tremor of the hand and voice is not a feature. If there is tremor of the head and voice, think of essential tremor or some other alternative diagnosis. Now, this is classical bradykinesia that result in various manifestations, including mask-like face is one of the manifestations of bradykinesia. And you have discrete blink rate. Normal blink rate is about as respiratory rate, about 14 to 16 per minute. So they have reduced blinking rate, reduced rate of spontaneous swallowing resulting in drooling. And when you see them walking, if you don't find any signs of Parkinson's disease, ask them to walk, and then you will see there is loss of arm swing on the affected side. And then they blow in block turning. They don't turn like a normal quick. Just for the PGs, how do you demonstrate bradykinesia? You can demonstrate in the upper limb by using the tapping the finger and the thumb, index finger. Then you can have opening and this finger hand movements, and then you can pronation, supination, and you can demonstrate. So these are the different maneuver we do for demonstration. Rigidity, as you know, this is increased resistance felt during the passive movement of the joint. We have two types of pattern in Parkinson's disease. One is plastic type and uniform increase in the tone. Another, there is superimposed tremor resulting in jerky movement, which is described as Cobb rigidity. And sometimes patient has severe flexor posture, which is called temptocornea. And then there are abnormalities related with posture and balance because of the impairment of the postural writing reflexes that results in falls. And you can check this postural imbalance by doing the pull test, which I will demonstrate. You just stand behind the patient and just pull it backward. And normally after one or two steps, you need to stop. But a Parkinson's disease patient will continue to fall backward. So you have to be careful that patient does not get any injury. Sometimes severe abnormalities of the spinal posture abnormality, you can see this called Pisa syndrome. You have that torsion of the trunk. This is just the writing before, after the treatment. Non-motor symptoms are as important as motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. And sometimes they present, they are there, but they are not diagnosed before the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, like loss of sense of smell. Similarly, sleep disturbances may be present for many years before patient develop Parkinson's disease. And cognitive impairment or autonomic manifestation usually takes few years after the diagnosis of the Parkinson's disease. And behavior disturbances, initially anxiety, but as the disease advances, you have psychotic features as well. Now, what should be the approach for the patient with Parkinson's disease? First, confirm that patient has symptoms and signs of Parkinson's disease. Second, review the atypical loss. Some negative thing you have to look carefully whether they are present or not. So I always, before I say this is Parkinson's disease, go for negative thing. If they are not there, if they are there, this is not Parkinson's disease. Do you need investigation? Yes, you need investigation to rule out secondary causes. Parkinson's disease, clinically, Parkinson's disease is a clinical diagnosis. And reassessment and review. You diagnose patient Parkinson's disease today, maybe after 1 year, diagnosis is changed to some other disorder, particularly PSP. These changes are very, about 20% of the patient may not have Parkinson's disease when you see on the first visit. It's long list of differential diagnoses, the condition we can mimic with Parkinson's disease. But important things are, we are talking about the atypical Parkinsonian features. And they are, atypical feature may not be apparent initially. That is why this is the reason for the late or delayed misdiagnosis. 30% of atypical Parkinsonism patients show response to levodopa. And initial diagnosis of idiopathic PD may prove wrong in 20% of the cases. These are the four typical atypical Parkinsonian syndrome which you need to consider in the differential diagnosis mainly. other than the secondary causes of Parkinson's disease. So these are the other neurodegenerative conditions, PSP, MSA, CBD, Lewy body dementia. And a couple of these things you have to carefully look in the history and examination. Patient has early fall, this is not Parkinson's disease, this is PSP number one, another condition. Cognitive impairment. Cognitive impairment in Parkinson's disease occurs late. If somebody present very early, then this is not Parkinson's disease. Myoclonus, you're thinking of MSA or corticobasal degeneration. Eyesight, PSP. Dysphagia, you're talking about either PSP or multiple system atrophy. Strider, you're talking about PSP, again CBD, MSA, and tremor of the head and voice is not a feature of Parkinson's disease. It may affect jaw, it may affect lips, but not that head. So this is the face of the, compared with the previous one, this is patient with PSP, the eyes are fixed, and if you look at the video, particularly downward gaze, but this patient has advanced PSP, very difficult to see, right, left, slow movements. This is called supranuclear ophthalmoplegia. To differentiate from nuclear and infranuclear, you can achieve good movement in response to doll's eye. That is why it is called progressive supranuclear. When you move them in response to eyes, they move in response to doll eye movement. This is walk. Compared with Parkinson's disease, they are walking with wide base, not narrow base. Our reasonable arm swing. But in Parkinson's disease, you saw there was loss of arm swing. So gait is different from Parkinson's disease. And this is pull test. Whatever, whether Parkinson's disease or other Parkinsonian, you see, you can't stop him. He keeps on walking backward. And this was his MRI. You can see there is atrophy of the midbrain, and this is called hummingbird appearance on MRI. So again, MSA, another atypical Parkinsonian syndrome. This is younger onset. You can occur any time after 30, usually 50s. And this is autonomic failure, plus evidence of Parkinson, Parkinsonism or cerebellar sign. Usually Western MSA has more Parkinsonian feature than the Eastern MSA. This is corticobasal, another Parkinson plus or atypical Parkinson. You have three features like marked asymmetry, may have myoclonus, rigidity, alien limb syndrome, cortical sensory loss is very important for diagnosis, and late onset cognitive impairment. These are the tests which you can perform, levodopa challenge test. You must need investigation to explore secondary causes like MRI. You have different functional angle MRI, PT, PET scan, SPECT scan, transcranial. I will just mention a couple of these things because they have become part of the diagnostic criteria. Initially, it was exclusively clinical diagnosis. And one of these functional imaging is called MIBG scintigraphy. This is the using the radioisotope called iodine-123 meta-iodobenzyl guanidine. This is a physiological analog of norepinephrine. This is a non-invasive tool for assessing the myocardial sympathetic nerve terminals. Now, what is the finding? In patients with Parkinson's disease, cardiac uptake of MIBG decreases from early stages of the, even before the diagnosis of PD. So PD patient has marked decrease in the MIBG intake. It correlates with severity of the hypokinesia and rigidity. Number three, the sensitivity of the MIBG cardiac scintigraphy is 80 to 90%. It's a very sensitive test that can pick up the changes which are early in Parkinson's disease. And this is the result. Above you see the normal, and below you see the reduced uptake. And the another functional imaging is the DAT scan. The sensitivity is 78%, and you can see the difference between the two sides. DAT scan basically check the presynaptic dopamine transport system. So you can have the presynaptic level for the diagnosis. And what is the result? Sensitivity 78%, specificity 97%. What is the problem with this test? You can see it will be abnormal in all the conditions which are associated with Parkinsonian features like Parkinson's disease, Lewy body dementia, MSA. But the important thing is this will be normal in patients with essential tremor and other causes of secondary Parkinsonism plus Alzheimer's disease which may have extra pyramidal features. So you can differentiate Lewy bodies from Parkinsonism associated with Alzheimer type dementia. So it has got a value in the differentiation between the two conditions. Then you have other flow, this imaging, and this is a marker of the terminal DOPA decarboxylase activity and dopamine turnover. You can see MSA mark reduction, but in PD this was not much affected. And now I will just, in my last talk, we will talk about what are the changes in the update in the diagnosis. And this revision was done by MDS Society, and this was published last year in October 2015. And now where will you stand? So this is the MDS diagnostic criteria 2015. For the diagnosis of Parkinsonism, you need bradykinesia. So that means bradykinesia must be present in all cases of Parkinson's disease, plus you need resting tremor rigidity or either alone or both. But clinically established Parkinson's disease you can diagnose when Parkinsonism is present and there are no exclusion features, no exclusion criteria present, at least two supportive criteria and no red flag. That means in order to develop clinically established Parkinson's disease, you need to know absolute exclusion criteria. You need two supportive criteria and no red flag. So you need to know the knowledge of these exclusion criteria, red flag and supporting criteria. So these are the absolute exclusion criteria. If they are not there, so you cannot diagnose Parkinson's disease. So if they are there, this is not Parkinson's disease. So absolutely exclude Parkinson's disease. If cerebellar abnormalities is there, if there are downwards gaze palsy is there, if there is frontotemporal syndrome, if the disease is confined to lower limb for more than 3 years, drug-induced Parkinsonism, lack of response to high DOPA, levodopa, exclude this Parkinson's disease, cortical sensory loss, and then you see the investigation, normal DAT scan. So if normal DAT scan, that exclude Parkinson's disease. Alternative explanation of Parkinsonism more than Parkinson's disease. And these are the red flags. You should be thinking that we are not dealing with Parkinson's disease. If you have some of these features, right, rapid decline and wheelchair-bound status within 5 years' time, you have progression, a static, no progression for 5 years. Parkinson's disease continue to progress. You have early severe bulbar functions impairment, inspiratory problem, autonomic failure in less than 5 years' time. So this is the long list of those which are red flag and you must remember and must take into account before you label the patient with Parkinson's disease. Now these are the supportive criteria, and that means clear and dramatic response to dopaminergic therapy, presence of L-dopa-induced dyskinesia, resting tremor of a limb, olfactory loss, or cardiac sympathetic denervation. So here we have another investigation that if a MIBG scintigraphy is there, then this is a supportive criteria for the diagnosis. So this is just a summary of the MDS criteria. One, established Parkinsonism, you need bradykinesia. That is important. So 100% of the cases. Then either resting tremor or both. If they are not there, you're not dealing with Parkinson's disease. But if they are there, you go to the second step. That is, patient has absolute criteria. If they are absent, then you have, can establish clinically established Parkinson's disease, providing no red flag, two supportive criteria. Clinically probable Parkinson's disease, two or less than two red flags balanced by equal number of supportive criteria. And not clinical Parkinson's disease, more than two red flags, you cannot diagnose them, despite the patient has bradykinesia and one of these features. And if these exclusion criteria are present, then there is no Parkinson's disease. So this is the summary of what is now recommended by the MDS. And this is the new definition, and this is the most recent article about the diagnosis, new diagnosis and diagnostic criteria for Parkinson's disease. Basically, it addresses the same and goes into detail. So finally, what has changed? Parkinson's disease is now defined as synucleinopathy. Parkinsonism remained defined as bradykinesia plus rigidity or both. However, postural instability is not a core feature. This may occur in many other conditions. And dementia was removed as an exclusion criteria from Parkinson's disease, even if it was presenting. Now people say this may be a non-motor manifestation, of Parkinson's disease, which may occur even before the diagnosis. So these are the new changes in the diagnostic criteria which we're using before, and that was UK Parkinson's Disease Society Brain Bank criteria, and that was about 25 year old. It was published in 1992. So after 25 year, we have a change in the diagnostic criteria this year. And now we come to the same slide. So what did we learn? So new definition, yes. Postural instability is not a core feature, yes. And presence of dementia exclude diagnosis, no, it may be there. Lack of response to high dose levodopa constitute absolute exclusion criteria, yes. Normal dent scan exclude, yes. Cardiac sympathetic denervation on MIG is supportive of PD, yes. And the UKD criteria is the most latest criteria, no, we have no MDS criteria. So thank you.